Hello, my name is Gabriella Segura. I am in Professor Helton's WRC-1023-027 class. I am in Group 5 with Brendam Redell and Alex Sedillo. And today we will be analyzing and evaluating three different ads, all at which utilize one of Jib Fowles' basic appeals for advertisement. We chose the basic appeal of the need for affiliation as our main theme. So we have three ads today that we will be discussing, all at which surround the need for affiliation. The need for affiliation is the need to be accepted, the need to be admired, and the need for friendship. All of these feelings are associated with the need for affiliation, and marketers utilize this appeal so that viewers can feel all of these positive feelings and essentially purchase the product or good that they are trying to sell. If viewers feel that they are included or that they will get friendship out of buying the product, then that's just a plus for marketers as they're doing a good job in persuading viewers to purchase the product. So we have three ads today. We have an Audi ad, we have a Nike ad, and we have a Coca-Cola ad. They all appeal to the need for affiliation, but they also have different appeals that are utilized, which we will discuss later.
Some see a new motor. We see a new era. Some see what's there. We see beyond. Audi.
All right, so based on the Audi ad that was just shown, it is very evident that the need for affiliation is prominent within the ad. Audi is advertising a basic mode of transportation, a basic machine with wheels that gets you from point A to point B. There is nothing more to it really, but they tend to spice it up by saying the brand name, giving all the utilities that come with the vehicle, any upgrades that you might be able to get. But in reality, bottom line is that it's a machine that gets you from point A to point B. It's no different from a Nissan, it's no different from a Toyota. It gets the job done. So adding the brand in is kind of Audi's way of giving viewers a sense that if they purchase it, they're going to feel more prestigious. They're going to have more friends because they have this, you know, brand car, when that's not necessarily the case. Audi refers to all products in the ad. There's nothing special about it again. The brand name tends to give a sense of prominence to those who are viewing the ad, and they feel that if they purchase this product, then they will also feel the prestigious, you know, of high social status feeling that the ad is trying to convey. That is how marketers get you, because they're telling you all these great things that you want to hear, when in reality that's not necessarily the case. The target audience of the ad would have to be those from middle class to high class. Audi is not an inexpensive vehicle. It tends to be a little more costly, so they're not going to target, you know, the lower class citizens who cannot purchase that type of vehicle. They can definitely try. And since the ad is just out on television, on YouTube, on different sources of media, the ad is going to reach those who unfortunately cannot purchase that type of vehicle. But however, once that ad is put out into the, you know, social media or YouTube, television, it will reach a lower class citizen, and it's up to that lower class citizen to, you know, take it upon themselves to go to an Audi lot and see if there is a reasonable price that fits their budget, you know? So it really is up to the consumers at that point, but it is the target audience of middle to upper class citizens. In the ad itself, there are several of Jib Fowles' basic appeals of advertisement that are used. There is the need for affiliation, the need for prominence, the need for attention, and the need for escape. This ad shows a group of people coming together, it shows the Audi driving, and it kind of sets it up like you want to go on an adventure with your new friends. As I stated in the beginning, it is mainly focused around the need for affiliation. So they kind of make you feel that if you purchase this basic machine with wheels, that you're going to make these new friends, you're going to set yourself up for adventure, you're going to draw attention to yourself, you're going to have a higher social status because you have a brand named mode of transportation. Now, this isn't necessarily the case in society, but marketers tend to use this strategy in order to play a factor in consumers going to the Audi lot and fulfilling their needs. So I think that that's very, it's obviously manipulative of marketers. However, it is a strategy that works for many, many people, and it gets them. So, furthering on the topic of cost, the average Audi is about $40,000. So definitely out of several people's price range. So that factor kind of ties in with who is going to have a hard time with the ad and who's going to have a hard time contributing to going to an Audi lot and purchasing the product. $40,000 is a lot of money. And when it comes to choosing $40,000 Audi or a $20,000 Nissan, I think that it's going to be not too hard of a decision for those who can't afford, you know, the more luxurious vehicle. So it's just very interesting to see how marketers target their audience and who they need to. And I think that they effectively target the audience in a way, especially with this ad, they effectively target their audience so that, you know, if they might not reach the target audience, well, they still have, you know, like the lower class citizens who they could still get to the lot and they can still, you know, they have a chance of getting them to purchase it. So all in all, I do believe that the ad was effective. I do believe that it's when it reaches the target audience, you know, they are definitely going to make a sale because that need for affiliation, that need of prominence, it reaches the target audience and it gets them, it reels them in, makes them feel like if they have this certain product, this certain basic machine with wheels that gets you from point A to point B, that you're going to be of higher social status, you're going to make more friends, you're going to build friendships, you're going to have more adventures, you're going to escape and have all these positive aspects if you purchase this certain product. So I think that that is crazy that, you know, marketers do that. And this ad especially was, the marketers did an excellent job in my opinion. And for our next ad, we are going to hear a Nike ad from Alex.
Hi, I'm Alex Sedillo, and I will be going over the Nike Air Max 1.
Ready?
Yeah.
Go.
So this ad features Nike's newest shoe at the time, which is nothing more than just a regular Nike running shoe that features an airbag under the heel for cushion and can now actually be seen from the outsole. So the name of this product is called the Nike Air Max 1, which air meaning it has the airbag cushion in the sole of the shoe, max meaning that the airbag is visible from the outsole of the shoe, and the number one being the first edition of this particular line of shoe. Now at the time, this ad was tailored more for avid runners, athletes who are training, or just active people in general. Now, the argument that Nike is attempting to make is that by wearing this new and innovative sneaker, athletes will not only be better runners or have better results for training, but their bones will be grateful as well, that they are wearing a technologically more advanced shoe. Nike uses logos, pathos, and ethos, as well as multiple of Jib Fowles' appeals to marketing, in order to get their argument across. Nike actually appeals to logos really early on, by simply just demonstrating the technology of the sneaker, the visible airbag, I guess, in the outsole. As well as, there's another appeal kind of that really stood out to me, kind of just off the jump here. It was the need for affiliation. Mostly because throughout the ad, we see the skeleton with the Nikes on, winning the race, as well as staying together and not losing any bones. This kind of implies that, you know, there's multiple different implications here, but the need for affiliation is really the most blatant one, I guess, out of everything, at least to me, because the skeleton with the Nikes on came out on top for everything and had better results. This basically says that if you're wearing Nike and you associate yourself with the brand, then you'll be just like the athletes you see on TV, or even just the skeleton that we just saw winning a race, or like those athletes, like I said, winning gold medals and winning championships and things like that. Now, this does directly correlate with the need to dominate, especially in this case, which is to dominate your competition. I think the skeleton with the Nikes on beats the skeleton with the unbranded shoes on, obviously on purpose. To show that, you know, if you're wearing these Air Max 1s, you're going to smoke your competition no matter what. If you're wearing Nike, you are a winner. I think this need for domination kind of also satisfies the need to achieve, as well as the need for prominence, which I'll get into. But the need to achieve, mostly because the ad shows that with these Nikes on, you can achieve your goals, maybe of beating that kid, you know, who really makes you upset and always beats you in track. Or just push yourself to achieve, you know, goals that an active person has set for themselves. Maybe, you know, to go win that 5K or go compete in that marathon that they want. Now, like I said, winning, the winning aspect, I think also appeals to the need for prominence. You know, domination, of course, but I think the need for prominence comes in here as well. Because with winning kind of comes that social clout, especially today. So what I mean by that is, if you're wearing these new sneakers, right, and winning all these races and achieving your goals, you kind of become the envy of all your friends. And, you know, even the people that you're not so much friends with are going to look for a reason to know you or say that they know you just because you're winning all these races and you're kind of this amazing athlete, right? And finally, I think the need to feel safe, as well as ethos and pathos, comes into play here all at once, especially with the last thing that the skeleton says, which is, quote, Nike Air, keep your bones alive longer. I think this quote obviously is ethos because of a skeleton saying that they are better off with these Nikes on rather than those shoes that were unbranded. And, you know, it's a skeleton. It's made of only bone. Obviously, they're going to know something about keeping their bones alive, right? So this, along with the other skeleton falling apart during the race, shows that, once again, if you're wearing these Nikes, your body is going to be winning as well, because this sneaker's new technology keeps your bones from taking so much impact while running. And, obviously, if you know anything about runners or just active people in general, longevity of the body is extremely important. Now, I think this also, with Nike knowing that, I think it kind of plays into that fear, which obviously is pathos. It plays into that fear that runners have of potentially not, you know, having good longevity and having to stop running sooner in life than if they if they are wearing the Nikes, right? So if you're not wearing the Nikes, then you're probably going to have to stop running sooner in life. But if you are, then, you know, you can probably run for a couple more years, right? Now, I do think that Nike would probably have an issue persuading people who are non-athletes or just not as active people in general. I think with an ad geared more toward athletically competitive people, it could be challenging to really show how much better the Air Max 1 is compared to other brands that are intended really just for everyday use. I think if someone isn't going to use their Air Max for running or for training, things like that, then there really is absolutely no point in buying this shoe. If you do, you're really just buying the brand. I think a different shoe could work just as fine, especially if it's just for everyday use. So the original price of this shoe was actually $75. And today that would be about $140 to $150. Now, compared to the Adidas TRX running shoe, which cost only $20, the price difference was quite big. $55 is a pretty big, you know, price jump, especially in the economic situation back then. And Nike really had to give tangible evidence as to why consumers should spend that extra $55 on their shoe. Now, I will say that I think the argument was effective overall, especially at that time because of the way that Nike pushed that Air technology agenda. I think that Nike was ahead of the curve in trying to find different ways to create comfortability in their shoes, which in turn persuaded so many people to buy them because nobody else really had, you know, air in their shoes or any type of extra cushioning to persuade, you know, consumers to buy their shoe. For me, as someone who has been an athlete my entire life and is still very active, I most likely would have fallen for this ad, and I probably would have been begging my mom, you know, to take me to the mall or to whatever sports store was carrying these shoes at that time. And now I'll actually be introducing Brendam Redell, who will be analyzing a Coca-Cola ad.
I'd like to buy the world a home and furnish it with love. Grow apple trees and honeybees and snow white turtle doves. I'd like to teach the world to sing.
Sing with me.
Perfect harmony.
Perfect harmony.
I'd like to buy the world a Coke and keep it company.
So the advertisement that I will be discussing is a Coca-Cola commercial from 1971 named I'd Like to Buy the World a Coke. The product, obviously, is Coca-Cola, which is essentially just flavored and carbonated water with lots of sugar and caffeine added in. And I'll play the ad now. So the product, Coca-Cola, got its name from two different plants from which some of the ingredients came from. The first is the coca plant, which is where the drug and at the time ingredient cocaine comes from. And then the second plant is the cola plant, which is where caffeine comes from. The combination of the addictive and energy-giving components of the drink gave it its name, which is now iconic, Coca-Cola. Today this has almost nothing to do with the drink, as cocaine obviously has been eliminated from it, and the caffeine dosage has been lowered by a substantial amount, being even less than a standard cup of coffee. Something that Coca-Cola as a company has done has adopted the name Coke, which was previously used as more of a slang term. And they did this in order to become more personable with their consumers or just the general population. The audience for this ad is the younger people, maybe mid to late 20s and 30s, specifically in the United States. And I kind of got that just from, or based off of how the people in the commercial looked, who were singing. Excuse me. And the general argument is that what the world needs at the moment of the commercial is a Coke. Though this is a very generic statement in today's terms, it's one that was focused on bringing the world together at the time when things such as the Cold War and the Civil Rights Movement was kind of tearing the world and America specifically apart. The ad uses multiple of Jim Fowles' 15 basic appeals. And the first one I'd like to start off with is affiliation. This appeal becomes very obvious the longer the ad goes on. As we can see, the ad includes people of multiple nationalities and races all singing the same song together in perfect harmony to promote a single product. The first aspect of the advertisement that satisfies this appeal is the fact that all individuals are shown showing real companionship, sharing the same dream, and sharing the same understanding of what the world needs at the moment. The second aspect that satisfies this appeal is the implicit or natural desire to be included with multiple races and genders included in the video. The ad was designed to make sure the target audience would feel left out if they didn't have a Coke, since someone who they could identify with was holding one in the video. And this brings out the element of ethos also in the advertisement. If people from around the world, all over the world, Asians, African Americans, Europeans, were all saying the same thing, then it must be true. The second appeal that the ad uses is the need to feel safe. In the ad, the song mentions a quiet house, furnished in love, and it includes mentions of white turtle doves all singing in harmony. And this brings out the component of pathos, as the turtle dove has traditionally been considered a symbol of love and innocence, which leads into the idea of being in good company. Having multiple symbols and images of love, peace, and unity creates an inviting environment, which the target audience would obviously try to seek out. In a similar vein, the need to feel safe plays a smaller role in the ad, only having one line, specifically, "I'd like to buy the world a Coke and keep it company." This simple line conveys the message that the consumers of Coke created a community where they will all feel safe and live peacefully together in like unity. The need for aesthetic sensation also plays a pretty large role in this advertisement. The landscape where the video was shot, it's on top of a beautiful hill in Italy, where people from all over the world are just standing and singing. And at the end of the advertisement, the company has some lines come down the screen, making sure the audience knows that the commercial was shot in Italy. And this was done in an effort to make the product seem more exotic or luxurious, which in turn would make the American consumers more likely to purchase the product. The beautiful landscape also makes the consumer feel, or not feel, focused less on the product and more on the visually appealing background, which, along with the song, creates a perfect environment for communicating the drink. And an appeal that's very similar to the need for aesthetic sensations, that plays a smaller role, is the need for escape. In the ad, this is created by having the ad take place obviously on a very peaceful, beautiful hill. And this location appeals to the audience by giving them a destination that many would want, which is a peaceful escape from their everyday, busy, hectic life. And this also similarly ties in with the need to feel safe, as since the location is very peaceful in the middle of nowhere in Italy. The audience is meant to feel as if they're in a tranquil environment, far away from their struggles of their everyday life. Unfortunately, this commercial doesn't contain any elements of logos, but it does, or as it primarily focuses on the emotions of the consumer and of the and focuses also on the individuals portrayed in the video. Some people that the ad might have trouble persuading are people who have maybe more racist viewpoints. Since the commercial was shot in 1971, this was when America was coming out of the civil rights movement, which saw African Americans gaining rights for the first time in almost 100 years. And there would most likely be a lot of people in the country, especially whites, who would believe that colored individuals should be treated as lesser. And as a result of that, seeing them in the ad would maybe turn them off of buying Coca-Cola. And in terms of price, Coke cost about 5 cents for a bottle back in the 70s. And for reference, Pepsi costed around 10 cents per bottle. This price difference was good for the product, obviously, because it allowed Coca-Cola to not only have their advertising strategies, but also their lower price point in order to leverage the consumers more to their side. And overall, I would say that the advertisement is extremely effective for multiple reasons. The first being that it uses multiple appeals from Jib Fowles very effectively. The second being that it created a perfect environment by filming the commercial in a beautiful area in Italy. And the third being that it just became one of the company's most popular and beloved commercials, even to this day, with tens of millions of views, and presumably persuading people even today to buy their product.
Alrighty, so that will conclude our presentation. Today we got to see exactly how Audi, Nike, and Coca-Cola all use the need for affiliation, as well as logos, ethos, and pathos, and a few more of Jib Fowles' basic appeals, and how they kind of all tie in together. Like we said at the beginning, our main theme was the need for affiliation, and we got to really see how the need for affiliation also brought about all these other appeals as well. So we hope you enjoyed and have a great rest of your day.